Hi, everybody, and welcome to Paul Lisnick Behind the Curtain, my opportunity to step away from the world of politics and law you watch me cover on television every day and enter the world of my true passion, which is theater and the arts. Well, okay, law and politics are passion too, but when it comes to theater and the arts, this is just gives us life. And so I am really totally excited because you're meeting pretty much the entire cast along with the musical director, and you see her on stage as well, of a new Sondheim tribute that is going on at Theo Ubuque. We've had Theo shows on here before. You've seen me present those. This one blew me away. I was at opening night. It blew me away for a lot of reasons. And I reached out and said, can we have everybody? And here you all are. So thank you, everybody, for being with me.
Thank you.
And let me just quickly introduce you. I'll just do you in the order, at least, that I see you, because this is an ensemble show, so there's no star of it. I know each of you think you are, but there's no real star. Well, I did do. I recently did this at Sweeney Todd, where everybody says, no, actually, I am the star. Okay. But anyway, Joe Giovannetti, you are with us, and you were in Full Monty. You've been at Porchlight, actually. I've seen you in some stuff there, Chorus Line, whatever. It's just fabulous. We'll go across to the other side of me, assuming our viewers, people, I know a lot of people listen to this, but for the viewers who see this, and Carolyn Brady, you are the musical. You have to be here, by the way, because of some of my questions, like, it's got to be you, and you might even surprise Ooh. The cast with some of your answers. You are the musical director, but you're also the pianist in the show.
Yes.
So you get some lines and everything.
Yeah, I do.
Fabulous. Maliha Sayed is with me, who had all her friends there on opening night. And so, but well, at least one. And they bring their parents. I think that's a wonderful thing to do for the show. This is your debut with Theo. So congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Max DeTogne. Did I get it right, Max?
You nailed it.
All right. And of course, I loved you. You played Jesus. Were you playing him? You played Jesus in Jesus Christ Superstar. You were an altar boy. Just so many things. Beard, no beard. We never know how we're going to get you. And so congratulations to you, which is just great. I just love it. And also, all right, let me not mess it up. Elya?
Beautiful.
Bottiger, good to see you as well. This is your debut too, right? But you were poor. Yeah. I saw you in Gypsy at Porchlight. You were fabulous in that.
Thank you. It was
all right.
So much fun.
We may have Issa join us as well. One other cast member, we'll see, because I know they had a schedule issue. So we'll see how that goes. But let's get started. Hey, Carolyn, I'm going to come to you initially because, first of all, one of the things that initially blew me away before I did my homework was, you know, whenever you do a review, it's what's going to get selected, what's going to be in there. And I will provide you with what I think should be in there because that's what you want from me. But right after the show, I went to Fred. Let me tell you what you're missing. It was just, it's an amazing, no, there's only one song. There's only one. And I'm going to see whether you guys agree with me or not. But Carolyn, talk about the process because this was a gift to theater companies around the country from the Sondheim estate.
Right. Well, so the way, well, the rules that were sort of set
and there
forth
are rules,
to
yeah.
us, right. You could perform pieces of music from Sondheim's work where he created both lyrics and music. So that narrows it down to a
West Side Story.
Right. It approximately 12 shows and no more than 3 pieces of music per show. So we kind of have, I think it's some shape or form addressed at least 3 pieces from those 12 shows or so. And the way we started the process was really before I came on, even on board, Fred reached out to the actors, as did Jay and Jenna, who were assistant director and choreographers. And they asked the cast, hey, what Sondheim pieces, give us like your top 3 or so, what you've always loved to sing. And we knew that we wanted to kind of reimagine these things. And so we shifted keys to be appropriate for each voice. Or there was a male identifying actor singing what is traditionally a soprano aria. And to illustrate the power of the music and how when you extract that piece of music from the story that it's written for, it can really take on even further and more personal meaning to each of us in the audience.
It was amazing. And just the way, and by the way, for the press who came on that night, we were given a list because the order of some of the songs had changed and stuff. Carolyn, quick follow-up. What was that sort of a last minute thing? What stepped in to say, I'm going to adjust this a little bit? Part of
the
story?
Well, we knew we wanted 2 sets, and you know, we can call them an act or a set. We called them sets, and we wanted a nice flow. But we wanted Act Two to look different and feel different than Act One. And so you saw a costume change help kind of illustrate that and elevate that. But really, it was about pacing our actors. It was about telling a little bit of a story and having, of course, a comfortable flow. And just we judged and tweaked until probably first preview almost. So we thought in that program, let's list all the shows they're going to hear, but let's kind of surprise them and let's let them hear, oh, they're moving into the agony from Kiss Me. Oh, that's interesting. Like, yeah. So it kind of was like a discovery for the audience too, as we continued.
Just fantastic. And by the way, the other cool thing about this is, I mean, there have been Sondheim reviews. They're side by side by Sondheim. But that one was done back in the, 2006 or something. One was in the 90s. So what's great is you got some shows here that weren't in either of those reviews that were open to you. I want to do a little round robin if I can, because the other thing that I just fell in love with this production was the fact that we got your personal stories. I don't want to step into the drama from the show, but I do want to have you address it a little bit. This wasn't just about, let's teach the audience about Sondheim, which those Sondheim's reviews do, in my view, but this is about learning about you. So I got to that's why I feel like I know you all, even though we just started. You probably think I'm nuts, but the truth is I just feel like there's a kind of a little connection, because you shared things that I don't think you made up. I think they were real. I actually did ask Fred ahead of time in the audition process. Did somebody come in and go, I've never heard of Stephen Sondheim, and did they get cast? But I'm willing to learn. You're in the show. Joe, let me come to you first, because I mean, what we learn about you, again, not going to give too much away. I don't want to do that. I'm really careful about not giving secrets from shows away. My favorite example of that was Dear Evan Hansen. When I asked the cast ahead of time, is there anything I shouldn't give away? And somebody said, well, don't say that Connor dies. I'm like, Connor dies in the first 5 seconds of the show. What are we not giving away?
Right.
But Joe, you had a life as a teacher. So just tell us a little bit about how Sondheim stepped into your world, because I believed you in that show. Plus, we had a moment in that show together, exchanging candy and champagne. But talk to me about the power of the show for you.
Sure. So, as you alluded to, I tell a little bit of a story about how when I first graduated college, I went to school to become a music teacher. So I taught high school choir for 3 years. And it really transformed my life. And it was at a very young time of my age. So I was very impressionable. A lot of stuff coming at me at once, a very scary thing to be in charge a bunch of 14 to 18 year olds when you're 21. And run a choral program, run the budget, all of that stuff. It was a lot. So I tell a story a little bit about how, I kind of was going through a lot at that time, but then we did Into the Woods together as the school musical, and it sort of totally shifted my perspective on the whole experience. And I learned a lot from the kids, and, there was a particular song from the show too, that sort of spoke to me. And that's what I talk about in the show.
And by the way, so the song you select to do this, I mean, that becomes, I'm sort of curious, Maliha, let me come to you next. So just a bit about your story, because we get, more of it in the show, but I'm wondering whether there is a certain song that spoke to you, or whether you have your story and then searched for a song that spoke to it.
Yeah. Are you talking about a song that I sang, or just a Sondheim song in general?
No, I'm talking about the song tied to when we learn about you in the show.
Yeah. I auditioned with Green Finch, which Joe sings. And I said in my audition that I just loved how tortured Joanna was. I loved that he wrote a horror musical, because you don't really see those. And I just loved how, I loved how twisted it was, and how, the metaphor of the bird in the cage, and just that anguish, and just this sort of cabin fever and stir crazy energy of that character. I just feel like, especially for the time that it was written, it was cool to see that, because it didn't feel it still felt like she had a mind of her own. Like, she wasn't just her emotions weren't running away from her. Like, she was very aware of her emotions and how she felt. And yeah, I think Sweeney is just that one of those shows that made me really, really love Sondheim and theater.
Yeah. And Max, I think it was being alive. Well, here, by the way, one of the other great things about the show, if people come, there are people who don't know a lot about Sondheim. There's people who are some Sondheim fanatics. So there are songs in here. Is there anything secret about saying some of the songs that are in it? I can do that, right? Yeah. So, I mean, songs like Broadway Baby and Finishing the Hat, No One Is Alone, You Could Drive a Person Crazy. It's just fantastic. Now, I happen to sit with a friend of mine who is a critic, who's a Sondheim fanatic. So during the intermission, I had to look and sort of say, you know, it's very interesting. There's music coming from the stage, and then there's music coming from your seat, and it should stop. He was singing along, and even his wife kept hitting him. And stop it. Anyway, Max, what I noticed was, and I think it was in Being Alive, because you're in that song, and you were very close to me, you teared up.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So this show has been very collaborative, and we really created it from nothing. And that song, along with our closer, our time, they're both very reflective, and it really gives you a moment to like sit back and appreciate the people on stage with you. And it's such an intimate space that you really can't hide it, hide the emotions when you're feeling them. So you just kind of have to roll with it and get through. Hopefully your voice doesn't crack. But
So is the tears that I saw, which I found very moving. In fact, my friend Al started looking, goes, he's tearing up. I went, yeah, I think that's, you know, I mean, that's cool. That's a compliment, because it means you're really. So was that triggered? I wasn't sure if it was triggered by the message of Being Alive, the song, or was it triggered by what you just said, which is just this experience we're having?
Yeah. I mean, I think the two kind of go hand in hand. Our the way that Being Alive arrangement is written, it's very isolated towards the top. And then we kind of come together towards the end. So it does kind of make you feel like you're alone and you're going through this struggle of trying to figure out what it is you're doing, why being alive is important. And I just feel like that kind of brings it out of me.
Yeah. And if I can add, our awesome assistant music director, Evelyn Ryan, wrote that and arranged that beautiful rendition. So typically Being Alive is a solo, as we know, and fusing these three beautiful actors and voices together, I feel like it just heightens the emotions with her arrangement. So
it does. That's why, I mean, I was crying along with Max. So that's, yeah, that's why I wanted to know what was the reason for your crying, because I have my own reasons. And Elya, let's come to you and talk to me about, once again, the story we learn about you within the show and how the number that you select that is part of that story came about.
Of course. My story with Sondheim is a little different than my castmates. I grew up in a household that listened to a lot of Golden Age. We listened to the Great American Songbook. And so my style of musical is loud, happy, and in your face. So growing up, for me, Sondheim was always something that was too much. And in my family, we've always like made jokes about how Sondheim is too emotional. And then I got cast in this show, and part of my audition speech was me talking about how I was indoctrinated to not like Sondheim. And what happened was I ended up in this room with all these people who adored Sondheim. I dug deep into understanding who he was. And in my speech, I also tell the story of anyone can whistle, and my fault at not being able to whistle my entire life, and how I've kind of been hard on Sondheim. But the more that I've gotten to know him, the more that I've done this process, what I've learned is Sondheim is the composer who tells the story of actual life. He's the one who takes our actual experience of livelihood, and he doesn't throw on stage something that's supposed to make us all. He gives us escapism in a whole new way. He gives us a chance to be comfortable with being a human, or be uncomfortable and know that we're not on our own in that experience. So for me, this process has meant everything, because all of a sudden I am this huge Sondheim fan. And I think that I've watched every single interview with him now online, and I just fall in love with him more and more each day.
Yeah, I'm with you. Issa, hi. You got to turn your mic on. There we
Hello.
Go.
Hello. Yes, sorry. Hi.
So So Issa, let me ask you what you disclose a lot. You share a lot with the audience in the show, personal information about you that's fascinating to listen to. Talk to me a little bit about the reasons behind your selection of what you disclosed to the audience as we learn about you in this show and the song that got selected to accompany that, because each of you, of course, select, I assume you select a song that goes along with your sharing of your life with the audience.
Yeah, I feel like I said a little bit in my speech, but Sondheim has kind of followed me as a person throughout my life. I also started with like Into the Woods Junior, and that was my introduction in middle school. And then like I realized as I was coming to as a person, I had done his shows in moments where I had like felt so either uncomfortable in my body or just like realizing a new element of myself, and being able to dive into such like complex music and like drink all of that up as I am trying to figure out myself, like it was so refreshing and so like energizing. As Elya was talking about, like the work that he does is so truthful and so honest, and like me as a queer person and as like a trans person, listening to his words and feeling so, seeing that so many themes that I was experiencing were so universal, felt so incredible. And for me, I feel like Finishing the Hat is one that I've felt such a connection to growing up. It was one of the like songs that I would listen to and be like, oh, I want my voice to sound like that. I want to be able to have it feel like the way that he writes for voice, it makes it feel like it's entering and filling up a whole space and a whole like being. And I wanted to be able to feel like that. And like the effort and the work it takes to make a picture, but then realizing to the work that goes into making the song and also making the painting and putting all of your energy into it while also trying to take into account everything else in the world and having that balance and working on something and giving your all was what identified the most with me.
Yeah. Were you like Barbara Streisand and said, I'm about to change some lyrics, I don't care. and I think that was one of them. That's why I asked. By the way, Barbara always asks Stephen for permission. So just so you know. but I don't even care if you're Sondheim. Are you going to say no to Barbara Streisand? I don't think so.
Oh, of course not. No.
and by the way, Carolyn, I didn't mention up front, you are also, this is a debut for you for Theo. And one of the things that I think has always amazed me about Theo, with all due, I know you've been at Drury Lane and Marriott and so many, you know, of our great theaters. One of the things that I think, to me, Theo just stands out, with all due respect to every other theater company, but nobody seems to, in my view, respect the diversity, the acceptance of everybody for whoever they are and whoever they want to be. Nobody seems to match Theo. And I'm curious, with all the theaters you've done your work at, do you agree with me or am I off base?
Totally. Thank you for recognizing that and saying that. I work with casting directors at the regional houses who are, it is so important to them to embrace inclusivity and to have a diverse looking cast like what our world looks like. But I will say, I really believe Theo is one of those, I just touched my piano, one of the trailblazers, truly. And it was really important to me to say yes to this project, just because I love a challenge and I love the complexity. But who Theo is and the fact that it's an intimate space, the return to the Chicago storefront theater where I kind of cut my teeth as an actor back in the 90s, to me felt like just a renaissance, beautiful celebratory moment and decision for me, for sure. I think you're looking at music now that is not, oh, we have to stay in the same key, but people really wanting to take the time to say, let's celebrate your voice. Joe, let's make sure Greenfinch celebrates your instrument. Issa, let's make sure that the way we tell the story in Finishing the Hat, key-wise, really features and celebrates who you are. And I love that about Theo. So thanks.
Are you at the piano because we're going to be singing?
I thought I'd just accompany you and maybe you could close out with a little Sondheim or something.
Because You can make me that offer. I'll take you up on it, but it's the
name your tune. I'll look it up. I'll play us out.
I love it. Well, if it's my tune, it's going to be If I Were a Rich Man. So we leave the Sondheim world. the one thing I can get away with wherever I am. You know, Joe, one of the things I find interesting, and you've done, again, some traditional show, well, traditional, I don't know, Sunset Boulevard, Chorus Line. When I think of those shows, do you find, just as a performer, is Sondheim, and anybody can chime in, I'm just making sure I'm chatting with everybody, but back to Joe, do you find that Sondheim is a bit trickier and tougher to sing than many others?
Well, Sondheim is definitely a challenge to sing, for sure. And I think what's interesting about your question is that Sondheim, like, kind of spans, like, all different kinds of genres and all different kinds of styles. Like, I didn't think I was going to tap in a Sondheim review. That was not my pitch. Okay. They, you know, our amazing, like, choreographers and associate directors, Jen Shoppy and Jay Allen, knew that I could tap from sort of other experiences. So I didn't come in going, thinking that was anything Sondheim related. And they said, no, we know this great song from Saturday Night, and we know that you can tap, so you should do that. And so that's, you know, that's an instance where they kind of knew something and had a vision for it and brought me into the process instead of something like, you know, more contemporary, like some of his older stuff that I get to do in the show. So it's cool because I kind of get to do both things in this, but definitely Sondheim, it's a challenge. Like, there are so many lyrics, and they're so, like, wittily constructed, and they don't always necessarily, like, follow exactly what you might say, like the Dionysus lyrics, hilarious to memorize. It definitely is really difficult. And there are 30 songs in the show, maybe over 30. I can't remember the exact number.
I can give you a count, but go ahead.
Yeah. But definitely it has been a rewarding challenge to sort of conquer. We were talking about this the other day in the dressing room. We do everyone's 11 o'clock numbers from all of the entire show, one by one by one by one throughout the whole thing. So by the end, you're like, wow, I've expanded a lot of emotional and vocal. But it feels so great at the end because he writes in a way that makes you really, like, feel things and like matches that to, like, the vocal, like, kind of lengths you have to go to express those feelings.
So you cleared something up. You weren't tapping because you still thought you were in Chorus Line. That's not what was happening.
No. I did not think I was going to do that at all. They said, they said, bring your tap shoes. And I said,
okay. Cause Max looked at me and said, doing the wrong show. No, I'm just totally kidding. Maliha, Maliha, do you when you perform these songs, do you like the challenge of doing Sondheim? I mean, obviously you do because you auditioned, but I mean, given a choice, would you say, let me take a Sondheim challenge? Or would you say, no, I'm fine doing a Rodgers and Hammerstein or something like that?
I love the challenge. I think, like, I talk about this a little in my speech, but, like, that's what excited me about Sondheim was how complicated the music was. And, like, that Into the Woods prologue, learning that for the first time, and, like, I had never seen musical theater sheet music like that. And, yeah, it's just so exciting. And Glamorous Life is, like, one of the hardest songs I've ever had to sing. So, yeah, it's really wild. I think it makes you a better musician. It makes you a better actor, a better vocalist. So I think anyone who does musical theater should explore Sondheim, whether they like him or not.
Oh, it's so tough. By the way, Max, I keep talking about Jesus Christ Superstar, just kind of kidding you with that, but you also did Altar Boys and stuff. It's kind of a religious theme to the shows that you're in.
Yeah, seemingly. I make a joke of it, that there's a theme going on with how they cast me in shows. I play Jesus, the Lord, and I play Matthew, the disciple, and now we're singing about Stephen Sondheim, God, our God.
Yeah. Have you asked when we're doing Joseph in the Technicolor Dreamcoat?
Oh, I will. No, I can't do that. I'm sorry. You can cut that. And Lloyd Webber doesn't need to hear that. But
all right. I heard they're bringing Donny Osmond in for it, so don't worry about it. You're not.
Yeah. Perfect. Perfect. He's starting his non-equity tour. I love it.
I love it. Hey, how about you? The challenge of performing Sondheim versus, you know, I mean, look, Theo does all sorts of stuff. This is Sondheim year, but is that something you say, could you do your whole career just doing Sondheim? I could see it.
Oh, absolutely. 100%. Sondheim writes for actors. It's kind of like Sondheim's story where he's like, If you asked me to write a love song, I could never write a love song. But if you asked me to write a love song of a woman drinking a glass of, or a cocktail at a bar in a red dress waiting for a date, I can write you a great song. And I think that my favorite part about our cabaret is we're not being asked to play the characters singing the songs. We're asked to play ourselves singing these songs. Yeah. And all of Sondheim's songs are a puzzle where you have a problem in the beginning and you end up with a solution at the end. So this cabaret has taught me that Sondheim is really this master of creating these songs that help reveal to yourself who you are. Issa and I sing Unworthy of Your Love in the show, and we carpool sometimes, and we'll spend the entire time driving home talking about what we learned today from singing that song to each other. And we'll like, and it's made us open up to each other and have these beautiful heart to hearts about who we are as partners in relationships. And that's why I would always want to do Sondheim. He teaches so much more just by putting music on a page for us to explore.
Yeah. And Issa, you can agree or disagree with my theory. I think one of the reasons the Sondheim Revue works more than maybe other Stephen Schwartz or somebody might want to do is because so much of his music can be taken out of the context of the show, which was kind of a rule here in doing this from the Sondheim estate. You didn't get to say, let me tell you the story of Sweeney Todd. Mm-hmm. It gets taken out of the context, and yet every single song works.
I absolutely agree. Like, I think that because his lyrics are so honest and so vulnerable, we are able to like pull them out of context. And because we're approaching them as ourselves, it feels so heightened, and they still work, like especially in conversation with each other. I think it's so interesting. And Jay and Fred and Jenna did such a great job in creating a lineup that speaks to each other, like with the passion section working out of context and like kind of jumbled up, and it still works. And then leading immediately into You Could Drive a Person Crazy is like, so at first we were like, I don't know, but it like makes sense.
Yeah.
And like, even then, like the themes being so universal and like us approaching them with such openness and awareness of like who we are as people and like getting to know each other and then like meeting each other where we're at and just continuing to sing the songs in an honest way. I think they absolutely work out of context.
Yeah, it's so perfect. And by the way, in passion, I was so surprised. People don't do passion a lot. I'm good friends. I grew up with Greg Edelman. So if you know who Greg is, I'm about to go see him in Water for Elephants in New York. But of course he was in that show, and I tried to get him to get me cast as Fosca. That didn't work. But Carolyn, just, you know, okay. So here's what I want to do. We have a couple minutes left. This is the unfair, because I know that everybody that sees this show will then have a discussion of what songs they think should have been in the show. Sure. It's natural. I'm going to ask you if there's any song you think should have been in the show. But Carolyn, I'm going to tell you what song I think should have been in. But I think this is a fair request.
Okay.
Children Will Listen. What do you think?
Yeah, you know, okay. That one, the theme is established, and then all the different voices come in and are layered. So I suppose it could have been arranged as a solo, but maybe it would have been similar to what we did with Being Alive and making it a trio. I think the lyricism in that one and the fact that we sort of lengthened the Being Alive and put layers and builds in like it is, like is present in Children Will Listen, might have been too similar. But maybe Revue number 2, that's where we start with you.
Fair enough. Does any of you, we don't have time, but do you all know the story behind, I told Fred this, he didn't know it, the story behind Children Will Listen, what led to that?
What's that?
None of you know? Mm-mm. I'll just give it to you really briefly. It was about Sondheim's relationship with his mother, which was a terrible relationship. And apparently on her deathbed, he went to make amends with her. And she looked at him and said, the only regret I have in life was giving birth to you. And with that, he wrote Children Will Listen. That song blows me away every time I hear it, because it can be taken out of context. But when you put it in that context, it's a wow.
Yeah.
And so powerful. Joe, was there any song that's not in the Revue? Is this a fair question? But is there something you say, oh, maybe in volume 2 we'll do this?
Well, I'll say that I think that the way that the set list came out feels so perfect and special, because it like everybody has like a little piece of themselves in the show. You know, we all like, you know, as we kind of talked about, we all got to sort of like pitch a bunch of songs that we would.
Oh, you did. That's why I asked that. So you did.
Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, like, something on my list that like isn't in the show is like, I would love to sing like Steps of the Palace one day, because I just like love doing like soprano ingenue stuff. Mm-hmm. but like, I love how the set list panned out, but that's something I would love to do one
day. I love it. Maliha, anything specific for you, or you it looks like you play well.
I've said this a million times, but I would have loved to sing Joanna up the octave. It's my favorite Sondheim song ever.
I love it. Max?
So I had Children Will Listen on my initial list. But if you're looking, like working with the guidelines, the rules, you have to remove one of the other End of the Woods songs we have in order to make room for it, which is a tough negotiation.
Before we get cut off, I hate to do this because we're going to get cut off, but Elya, what quick song? Do you have a title?
Yeah, Side by Side from Company.
Fair enough, absolutely. And Isa?
You're going to Love Tomorrow from Follies.
All right. Carolyn, I love what you're doing. There's just so much. It's unbelievable. But Theo Ubuke is presenting the Sondheim tribute with these phenomenal performers through April 28th. Theo-u.com is where you get tickets. Don't miss this. This thing is going to just sell out, and I hope it gets extended for years. I know that can't happen, but thank you all for your time, for joining me. I can't believe we pulled off the full cast and Carolyn too. Thank you. I hope you all had fun. I'd had fun with you all, and you're just amazing, and congratulations on a great show.
Thank you so much. Thanks for this.